Welcome everybody to the Power Hour. I hope that you've come prepared to hear a word from the Lord. My greatest hope and prayer every time we preach out here is that you at least leave with something that you've either never heard before, or you're reminded about something you've forgotten, or the whole experience is just something that lifts you up before God. The preaching of the gospel is not intended to shed light on people. It's intended to shed light on God so that people see him. So whatever it is that you have come here for, whatever it is that has drawn you to this place, I hope that it ends and begins with the preaching of the gospel. Amen. Having said that, what was last week's message? Huh? Yeah, that's good. See, when you threaten people, they remember, right? Love wasn't doing it. I had to threaten you. Keep calm and listen. Today, the message is keep calm and learn. If there's anything that human beings are both gifted and cursed with, it is learning. Learning is a gift when you do it intentionally. It is a curse when it is forced upon you. Now, when you make a conscious choice to learn, amazing things come out of that. I have seen people who have been married and divorced 3 times, and now they're happy with wife number 4 because he's learned a lot in the past 3 marriages. Should he have messed up 3 times? Probably not. But he learned something. So keep calm and listen. As always, a little bit of housekeeping. Now, the learning is so much that I couldn't help. I'm sorry, but I had to do part 2. Okay, this is a part 2 within a part 2 of a sermon. Okay, so keep calm and learn is going to be a 2-part thing because there's so much to say and so little time. All right, let me begin with a couple of statements for you. Listen to this. Always walk through life as if you have something to learn, and you will. You will. It's like school. If you look at life like school, the good students, where do they sit? I don't know what school you went to, my brother, but the good students sit in the front. Why do they do that? Why do students like to sit in the front? Maybe they have a crush on the teacher, or they know that their classmates talk too much, so by sitting in the front, they get to focus and answer questions, right? But if you're a dum-dum like I was, you sit at the back of the class so that you don't answer any questions. Now, what some schools do is they will create a system where during an exam, all those who get the good grades sit at the back of the class, all those with bad grades sit in the front of the class. Maybe I should start doing that with church. If you're late, you sit at the front. If you early, sit at the back. That sounds cruel. Okay. The capacity to learn is a gift. The ability to learn is a skill. The willingness to learn is a choice. Learning is a choice. I said learning is a choice. You can't choose what happens to you. You can't choose what goes on around you, but you can choose to learn from it. I always tell people who are in jobs that they hate, where the boss keeps giving you so much work to do, or the boss gives me so much work, I say to them, isn't that an opportunity to learn? Isn't that an opportunity to get more? Oh, the teacher keeps giving me so much homework. That's good for you because you learn more. And that's what God does. So what are you going to do with the rest of 2019? Are you going to complain or are you going to learn? That's a choice you have. Because 2020 is around the corner. What you do with the next couple of weeks determines the way the next year begins. You cannot tell yourself, January 1, I'll decide what comes next. That's too late. Learning begins today. Learning begins today. Learning begins right now. Let's go to the Bible. Let's go to the Bible. I'm going to read a strange passage. There's so many Bible verses that can teach us how to keep calm and learn and not panic. But the one I've chosen is the story with the talking donkey in it. Because if God can't talk to himself, sometimes he'll use donkeys to do it. Let's go to Numbers chapter 22. Numbers chapter 22. This is, I must confess, in 20 years of ministry, it is the first time I've ever preached on this passage. Let's see how it goes. Numbers chapter 22. I'm reading from verse number 21. So the next morning, Balaam got up, saddled his donkey, and started off with the Moabite officials. But God was angry that Balaam was going, so he sent an angel of the Lord to stand in the road to block his way. As Balaam and 2 servants were riding along, Balaam's donkey saw the angel of the Lord standing in the road with a drawn sword in his hand. The donkey bolted off the road into the field, but Balaam beat it and turned it back into the road. Then the angel of the Lord stood at a place where the road narrowed between two vineyard walls. When the donkey saw the angel of the Lord, it tried to squeeze by and crushed Balaam's foot against the wall. Balaam beat the donkey again. Then the angel of the Lord moved further down the road, stood in the place too narrow for the donkey to get by at all. This time, when the donkey saw the angel, it lay down under Balaam. In a fit of rage, Balaam beat the animal again with his staff. Verse 28. Then the Lord gave the donkey the ability to speak. What have I done to you that deserves your beating me three times? It asked Balaam. And Balaam, like a wise man, began to respond to the donkey and say, "You've made me look like a fool." Balaam shouted, "If I had a sword with me, I would kill you." "But I am the same donkey you've ridden all your life," the donkey answered. "Have I ever done anything like this before?" "No," Balaam admitted. Then the Lord opened Balaam's eyes, and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the roadway with a drawn sword in his hand. Balaam bowed his head and fell face down to the ground before him. I am pretty sure that when you came to church this morning, you were not prepared to hear about a donkey that talks, but here we are. Because sometimes when God speaks and we don't listen, he will use anything available to him. Amen. The first place I want to begin, The first place I want to begin this morning is to tell you the backstory about all this. When God allowed his people to exit Egypt and head toward Canaan, one of the things that God did was make a promise to them that up to the point of this passage, he had kept. God promised them that if they trusted him, he would get them to the promised land. Not only would he get them to the gates, he would let them in, and by the time they got in, whatever enemies they faced, they would conquer them. By the time you get to this passage, Jericho has been conquered. All right, Jericho, the walled city, had come tumbling down. No sword was struck. No soldier was killed. But the walls came down simply because they obeyed God. Because when you listen to God, things work out in your life eventually. I'm sorry, I don't have any talking donkeys to repeat what I just said. Because when you obey God, things work out for you eventually. See, human beings don't like the word eventually. We want it right now. If you send a text, you want a response immediately. If you order food, if it's 5 minutes late, you complain to Gojek. You give the driver 3 stars, but your food has arrived anyway. We want it immediately. But the God I serve works eventually. Not because he's showing off, but he knows you better than you know yourself. So when you obey God, things work out eventually. I still don't have a talking donkey, but let's keep going. So the Bible tells us that in the story, God's people are moving through Canaan. And every nation that saw them coming became afraid because they heard about what was happening. Somebody tweeted or posted a picture on Facebook and said, "This is what happens when you go against God's people." And so King Balak sees Israel camped in the valley, and so he's thinking of a solution. How can I fight against these people and not lose? Because a kingdom bigger than mine has lost against them. What should I do? Every other nation would send soldiers and lose. But this king developed a different strategy. Because I want to tell you something that you probably don't know. Your enemies study you. Your enemies watch you to learn how to defeat you. The devil doesn't only know about your life. He knows about your parents, about your grandparents. He knows about your family tree. He knows about medical conditions you don't even know about that have existed through the generations. Yes, you know the names of the family tree members going back 700 years. But do you know that your great-great-great-great-great-grandfather proposed to his wife under an apple tree? The devil knows. The devil knows who's had an addiction, who's had a problem. The devil knows who was faking it before making it. He knows everything about you. He may not know as much as God does, but he knows more than you do. The devil knows you. The devil knows you. Do you know that the devil knows you? And so the king is studying the situation, and he realizes, if I'm going to conquer these people, I need to beat them with something no other king has done before. And so he makes the choice. I am going to hire the services of a prophet. He doesn't belong to them, but he knows about them. The devil always attacks you with the familiar. That's why the word familiar sounds like what? Family. He uses things that are common to you. In fact, let me put it this way. Most times the devil will use family. Many times he will use friends. Seldom will he use foes, because foes or enemies are the people that don't like you. The devil's not interested in using them. He's interested in people that know you, because when somebody knows something about you, they can use it against you. And so the king says, I'm going to hire the services of, in the Hebrew it's Balaam, but that doesn't sound cool, so we'll call him Balaam. He sends messengers to Balaam. Now, Balaam is not Hebrew, but he's very familiar with the God of the Hebrews. Abraham lived in the region of Mesopotamia, and Balaam came from that region. He once was a prophet for God, but he had apostatized and allowed himself to be a prophet for hire. He would get paid, and he would curse people and get money for that. And so the king thought, let me get somebody familiar with them so that he can help me defeat them. First statement I want you to kind of embed in the recesses of your mind. The enemy is smart enough to learn how to attack. Are you smart enough to learn how to avoid those attacks? That's point number one when it comes to learning. Are you studying the game? Are you a student of the game? Do you have the game tape for your life? Are you aware that the devil understands the concept of insanity? Insanity is doing the same thing and expecting different results. But the devil knows us. We are creatures of habit. He knows what you eat. He knows where you go. He knows what you do. He knows what you're thinking about without even reading your thoughts. He can look at the micro expressions on your face and tell that you are sad today. You are not happy today. The devil doesn't need to be your friend on Facebook, hashtag life sucks. He just needs to look at your face and know what's happening. And then he will send people on the day that you've had no breakfast, you fought with your family in the morning, that's the day the boss comes and asks for an assignment that's not finished. That's the same day something you ordered doesn't arrive on time. That's the same day you hear that somebody is sick. And that's the same day the pastor says, would you like to come join Bible study? And your answer is, I'm not feeling well, pastor. And the devil says, yay, I won the day. The enemy is smart enough to learn who to use in the attack. Are you smart enough to learn who to have as an ally? I haven't read the book yet, but I've read so many quotations from it. I think I should buy the book and read it. Oh, my wife is here. I think I should get a free copy online and read it. I'm addicted to books. The Art of War by Sun Tzu. You got to read that book. It's amazing. Now, when you read the cover, you'll think, The Art of War, he's teaching you how to make enemies. But in actual fact, that's not the case. So looking at the actions of this king, I was tempted to look at some quotes from The Art of War. And I want to share some of them with you that I think you can apply in your spiritual walk. All right? Take a look at them. Sun Tzu. The first quote says, the supreme art of war is to subdue your enemy without fighting. Anybody understand what that means? Took me a minute to kind of figure it out. How do you defeat your enemy without even lifting a finger? Some of the greatest generals in the past were armed with this idea. In fact, if you look at something as simple as the Vietnam War, I read something interesting. I don't know whether it was true or not. Please forgive me if you're below the age of 18. But the other day, a doctor taught a lesson and showed us a picture of a penis. I don't think I can do worse than that. So here's the thing. During the Vietnam War, what the American soldiers would do in order to attack the people, in the process of psychological warfare, they would drop literature or pamphlets or papers saying that the genitals of those people were smaller than theirs. Because nothing makes a man upset than challenging his manhood, literally. So for some people it worked that, oh, so you're saying that, you understand. So it affected their psychology. Because if the devil can get you here, he knows you can get you here. He knows that you love your job so much. If he attacks the job, you will lose your relationship with God. He knows that you have turned your boyfriend or girlfriend into God in your life, and if they walk away from you, you will not love God. So he attacks you in the physical, knowing that in the spiritual, he wins. People are afraid of demon possession, but that's not the most common thing the devil uses. The devil will use food, Pastor Sam, the devil will use Magnum almond ice cream to take away your love for Jesus. Because what would I be without Magnum almond ice cream? What would you be without your Pastor Henry Gado Gado or whatever it is that you love so much? The devil knows you. And so, as Sun Tzu says, to subdue your enemy, do it without fighting. And so the king thinks, if I send soldiers, God is going to click his finger, everybody going to die. Let me find somebody to curse them. The second one I found says, who wishes to fight must first count the cost. Sometimes we engage in battles that we are not able to fight. Sometimes we engage in pursuits that we're not ready for because we haven't counted the cost. But this king counted the cost. He found a prophet who was for sale. And the Bible says that he sent his messengers with silver and gold in their hands because he knew what it would cost to win this war. My question, my brothers and sisters, 16 November 2019, have you counted the cost of what it takes to be a spiritual giant? Have you counted the cost? Have you figured out how much preparation, how much dedication, how much focus you need to be strong in the faith? One more. One more. This one's long. Whoever is first in the field and awaits the coming of the enemy will be fresh for the fight. Whoever is second in the field has to hasten to battle will arrive exhausted. Now, obviously, you know today that soldiers don't have to go to battlefield. All they have to do is just press a button and a drone destroys everything. But in those days, you actually informed each other that on a Tuesday in the afternoon, we will meet and fight each other. So the soldiers would go to the battlefield and they would meet them. The smart generals would make their soldiers go at least a day before. Because remember, no tanks, no big vehicles to carry them. So they had to march to the battlefield. So what some generals would do would make the soldiers march a day before, get some rest, and wait for the enemy. Whereas the other soldiers, tardy as they were, would come tired to the battlefield. I'm like, one second, let me just catch my breath. And lose. Because they were already exhausted. What does that say about spirituality? Why is it that we show up for prayer when things are not good? What makes you think that this instant noodle spirituality is going to help you when somebody in your family has cancer? All these other months and days, you haven't been worshiping, you haven't been praying, and now that the devil has showed up, all of a sudden, you remember God. Granted, God is available for you, but guess what? You are not prepared for what the enemy will throw against you. And so what comes out of your mouth is not a positive recollection of the past. It is complaining, complaining, complaining. You must master the art of war because whether you know it or not, you and I are in a spiritual battle on a daily basis. When you go to your wardrobe to choose a piece of clothing, that's a spiritual battle. When you wake up in the morning to put food in your mouth, that's a spiritual battle. The moment you engage a human being, that's a spiritual battle. Whatever situation you are in, the devil can use it inch by inch, moment by moment, struggle by struggle to topple your relationship with God. He knows it. Do you? Please come and curse these people for me. Because they are too powerful for me. This man understands that without a strategy, he would be defeated. And so he says, curse them. Question, please respond. What does it take to curse somebody? Where do curses come from? I'm hinting. Where do curses come from? Go ahead and use yours. Where do curses come from? From the mouth. All right, one of the writers in the Bible says that you can, the mouth is able to curse and bless. It is able to set on fire and to build. So the enemy knows the power of words. Do you know the power of words? Not a big fan of social media still. It's a tool, not a luxury. But I loved Twitter when it was still 140 characters. You know when you talk too much, you know how much time you have to think before you tweet? 140 characters is not a lot. But then Twitter decided, let's double it. And now every Tom, Dick, and Harry is speaking his mind with 240 characters. And because of that, people think that expressing what they're thinking immediately makes them intelligent. But I want you to understand that the devil knows the power of words. So when you wake up in the morning and you insult somebody, when you insult the person that you live with, when you belittle someone you work with, you have no idea how affected that person is. There are people who are struggling in relationships simply because a mother, a father didn't affirm that they were special growing up. And so because of that, the lack of those words has created a vacuum of compassion. There is power in words. Amen. But God said to Balaam, don't go with them. It's amazing that the words that human beings speak are more powerful sometimes than the words that God speaks. Not because God is not powerful, but because we choose to listen to people than we choose to listen to God. The evil king tells Balaam, go curse them. Balaam says to the king, I must consult with God. God says, no, don't curse them. Is that statement difficult to understand? Let me come over here. Is that statement difficult to understand? Yes or no? Go ahead, use your mouth or your head. Is that statement difficult to understand? Don't go. No. Right? Therefore, thou 15-year-old, 16-year-old teenager, when your parents say don't go, what makes you go anyway? The parents are crazy? Or the teenagers are crazy? Oh, okay. Last week I preached about listening. The previous week I preached about living. Do you understand that both those things have something to do with learning? Because to learn, you must listen. Learning begins with listening. You listen through your ears and through your eyes. No, Pastor, you see through your eyes. No, you listen through your eyes. You look at what is happening. Let me ask you a question. Children, do they learn more based on what they hear or what they see? It's amazing that everybody without a child is the one that responded. But the parents seem afraid to respond to that. Your children, do they learn through what they see or through what they hear? They learn through what they see, not what they hear. It's the same with Christianity. It's the same with religion. People don't learn because they listen. They learn because they see. So in order to listen, you must see an example and follow it. That's why a life lived well is a good example for somebody else. But this prophet had become such a bad example that he didn't even listen to God. God said, don't go. But he said, are you sure? God said, don't eat the fruit. And the devil said, are you sure? And so we go through life asking the Lord, are you really sure that you said that? Or did you mean something else? Thou shalt not kill. Are you sure? Are there no circumstances where slitting a man's throat is okay? Thou shalt not steal. What do you mean? Do you mean a bribe or do you mean taking what belongs to someone else? Be specific, Lord. And God says, don't steal. See, we live in what I call, we live in the gray. We live in the gray. We love the gray area. Okay? People will debate the gray area all day. Because if you can cause a shadow of doubt, then it means I can do what I want. But God said, don't go. But Balaam said, I will go. So Balaam insisted on going. Then God said, okay, you can go, but don't curse those people. Why? Why? It's underlined. Don't curse them because they're blessed. Here's another thing that I want you guys to learn today. Your enemy knows that you are blessed. My question is, do you know that you are blessed? See, we think blessing means where things work out for you. But when God says you're blessed, it means that wherever you are the blessing. You may be in a job or relationship you don't like, but you're the one that's blessed. You may be lying in a hospital. That doesn't mean you're not blessed. And just to be clear, you are not blessed because you're perfect. You are blessed because God is good. Hashtag never stop learning. You are blessed not because you're perfect. You are blessed because God is good. And because of that fact, God says to Balaam, don't curse them because they are blessed. But I want you to understand, during this very statement, in the previous chapter, the people were complaining about God. But God said, they're blessed. They're complaining, but they're blessed. They're cursing God, but God calls them saints anyway. God is good. God is so amazing. that in spite of us, he keeps being who he is on a daily basis. Let's keep learning. And so the Bible says that Balaam decided to ignore God, and then he jumped on his donkey and made his way to meet up with King Balak in order to negotiate the terms on how to curse the people. On his way, this is what the Bible says. The Bible says that his donkey, by the way, it was a female donkey, doesn't mean anything. I'm just pointing out a fact. His female donkey sees an angel in the middle of the road, but Balaam doesn't see the donkey. The donkey sees the angel, I'm sorry, but Balaam doesn't see the angel. And so when the donkey sees the angel, the donkey stops. Balaam thinks the donkey is stopping because it's a donkey. Donkeys are stubborn animals. Have you ever wondered why donkeys are stubborn? I know you haven't. I know for a fact you haven't. I don't even know why I asked you. Who cares why donkeys are stubborn? I'll tell you why. Out of all the animals, especially the domesticated animals, the one animal that doesn't trust immediately is a donkey. In fact, if you look at its cousin, the horse, it takes a lot to train a horse to be domesticated. Donkeys have trust issues. I'm not saying that everybody with trust issues is a donkey, but I'm saying that donkeys have trust issues. Okay? So what happens is, if a donkey doesn't trust you, it won't do what you want it to do. It will just stand there. But if you put a carrot at the end of a stick, guess what the donkey does? It will follow. Because now you've offered it an incentive. Okay? So parents, sometimes you gotta treat your kids like donkeys and put a carrot at the end of the stick. Please close my son's ears. He mustn't hear that. Donkeys have mistrust. I want to keep talking about donkeys for some reason. So donkeys have trust issues. But once they get to know you, they will do anything that you ask. And I can tell you, based on this passage, Balaam and his donkey had an awesome relationship. The donkey says it later. Weird idea. The donkey points out to the donkeys can live up to 25 years. Okay? That's a long time for one donkey, right? So donkeys are loyal. They're faithful. But this time, this donkey sees an angel. Now, naturally, the donkey can't say anything, so the donkey starts walking off the road. Balaam gets upset, beats the donkey to come back onto the road. This happens three times. And because I like to talk, I will talk about all the three times. In the first time, the donkey goes off the road, he beats it back onto the road. The second time, the donkey is walking probably through a place like this with grape vines on the sides. And so while the donkey is walking, sees the angel and tries to go to the side and crushes Balaam's foot. Balaam can't see the angel, gets upset, beats up the donkey. That's number two. Third time. This time there's nowhere to go. The donkey sees the angel with a sword in its hand. And it just sits on the road and surrenders. Balaam gets off that donkey and beats it up so much, the donkey starts talking. It is difficult to see what God wants because you're blinded by what you want. I was asking myself, well, how come Balaam could not see the angel, but the donkey could? Is it because God closed Balaam's eyes? Or is it because Balaam closed his own eyes? Remember, God spoke to Balaam directly. No prophet, no priest, no dream, directly spoke to him. He ignored God. You know that things are bad when God has to speak to you through a donkey and not through himself. It's embarrassing, ladies and gentlemen, when your husband's best friend, ladies, comes to you and intermediates between you and your husband. Because your husband has tried so much to communicate how he feels, you're not listening, so his best friend comes. Gentlemen, isn't it embarrassing when your nephew comes to you and says that your wife is not happy? Isn't it embarrassing when the pastor comes to you and says, hey, listen, man, I've been talking to your wife and she feels like you're not paying attention to her. Doesn't that embarrass you? Or do you feel like, oh, great, the pastor visited me today? Positive affirmations. A donkey is talking to him. But Balaam is so angry, he doesn't focus on the fact that a donkey is talking. He is so angry that he doesn't understand what's happening. Why am I doing this? I'm trying to say to you that God has done his best throughout the whole year to speak to you through a whole bunch of different donkeys, including this one. 48 Sabbaths in the year talking to you, and he's saying through the word of God, God says, don't go. But we're always waiting for a message from somewhere else. We won't listen to God. We won't listen to a donkey. Who are we going to listen to? Then the Lord gave the donkey the ability to speak. What have I done to you that deserves you beating me three times? It asks Balaam. And Balaam says, you are making me look like a fool. By the way, Balaam has two servants with him. What would you do if you are Balaam's servants and you hear the master's donkey talking? Okay, that's strange enough. But then he responds back to his female donkey and says, you're making me look like a fool. We make ourselves look like fools on a daily basis and we just don't know it. We embarrass ourselves because of our faith. We shout to the mountaintops that we are Christians, but we don't live it. People don't see it, and then we wonder why donkeys start talking. Here's a word of advice. Don't wait until the donkey starts talking for you to obey God, because then it means that God has given up on you. But I'm the same donkey that you've been riding for life. Have I ever done anything like this before? And then Balaam admits, no, you've never. So for whatever number of years, the donkey has never disobeyed him. And for it to disobey him now means something is wrong. In that moment, the Bible says that the angel appeared and Balaam could see the angel. Common sense. Okay, can I talk about common sense for a little bit? Is that okay? Common sense? Does anybody know what common sense is? Do you know what common sense is? Common sense is 1 + 1 = 2. Common sense. Right? Common sense is not X times X equals Y equals Z. No common sense. Confusing. Let me give you an illustration of what common sense is. A father and a son were having a conversation. The boy went to church and learned about baptism. He was taught that when you baptize, you are immersed in water and then you come out. Because Jesus Christ was buried, his whole body in the tomb, he rose from the dead. So when we are baptized in a body of water, you come out with your sins washed away, symbolically speaking. And so the son is sharing this information with the father, and the father says, that doesn't matter. You can sprinkle on the head, you can rub on the side, doesn't, it's all the same thing. After all, you say the same thing. You bury it, it's done. One of the chickens died. And so this boy was told by the father, go bury the chicken. So he went around the house, threw the chicken on the ground, took some sand and sprinkled it and walked away. The father came and said, how could you do that? And the son said, it doesn't matter whether you bury it or sprinkle it. It's all the same thing. I think that children have better common sense than adults. Did all the kids say amen? Sometimes we complicate life as adults. We allow ourselves to be so drawn out by what we want that common sense doesn't make any sense anymore. One of the most expensive commodities in this generation is common sense. You hear me preach about it. I don't understand how people can love animals more than people. I understand Balaam talking to the donkey because the donkey spoke back to him. Can you explain to me why you talk to your animals? Sister Pam, I see you on Instagram talking to your dog. Has it ever responded back to you? I don't think so. But people would rather talk to an animal than actually talk to people. Some of you, you're not talking to your kids, but you're talking to your cat. Please help me understand that. It's time to learn. And then Balaam confessed to the angel, I have sinned. I didn't realize you were standing in the road to block the way. I will return home. Listen to him. I will return home if you are against my going. Didn't God say don't go? But now he's negotiating. He's like, are you sure that I shouldn't go? This is probably the most important thing in the message. I guess I've been thinking about this more than anything else. Listen to this. A dangerous enemy to spiritual growth is waiting for God to change his mind. I want you to think about it. What is it that you have forced into your life right now? You know what the Bible says. I don't even have to shout it at you. You know what the Bible says. But you're waiting for God to change his mind. In fact, you look for people that validate what you're thinking. You will go through 20 people who will tell you, no, the Bible says. And if you find just one person that says, It's 2019. It's okay. That's the one that you go with. Because it is a dangerous thing, my brothers and sisters, to think that even though it is the age of enlightenment, that God's word no longer is relevant. It's not the case. God means what he says. So for you to say, are you sure I shouldn't go? But listen to what the angel said. But the angel said to Balaam, go with these men, but say only what I tell you to say. And so Balaam went with Balak's officials. Wait, didn't you say that God doesn't change his mind? No, he doesn't. But God knows that you are not going to change yours. It's not God's resistance that should concern you. It's the lack thereof. When God doesn't punish you for doing bad, that should make you more scared than comfortable. Let me come over here. When God doesn't punish you when you do something bad, that should make you afraid, not comfortable. Because we should not be afraid of God resisting us. You know how it is when you're driving to that place and then the tire bursts or you run out of gas or things don't work out the way you want them to. You try to get into a business venture, doesn't work out the way you want it to. You try to cheat in an exam, but there's no internet so the paper doesn't get posted. You know what I'm saying? That's not the worst thing. The worst thing is cheating in an exam, posting it, and getting a good grade. Do you know when the punishment will come? When you're in the office because you got summa cum laude, and then the boss asks you a question, but you can't answer because you cheated in the exam. Then you know that karma is a bad thing. When God resists you, it means that he loves you. When God doesn't resist you, it means that he loves you, but he wants you to learn a lesson. If God does not resist you, sometimes it's because he's given up on you. So if you're doing bad, and nothing bad happens, it means that God has pretty much washed his hands of you. So God said to Balaam, okay, fine, go. But make sure you say what I tell you to say. It's not God's resistance that should concern you. It's the lack thereof. And now, what is happening behind the scenes? Behind the scenes, God's people are camped in the valley. They don't know that God and Balaam are having a conversation. They don't know that Balaam has the most miraculous animal in the world. Do you understand that if I was Balaam and I discovered that my donkey can talk, do you know how much money you can make with a talking donkey? But he's so blinded by disobedience that he doesn't even focus on that. Back to the story. So in the valley, the people have no idea all this is happening. No idea. So I was thinking to myself, what's the lesson in here for people that are coming to listen to the sermon? What's the lesson for them to understand that when things are happening in the background, sometimes God protects you from it because he doesn't want you to be discouraged. Can you imagine? It's Indonesia, like Africa. People curse each other, right? People cast spells. Can you imagine if somebody sent you a text message and told you that in the month of January 2020, I'm going to curse your firstborn child? Would you be happy with that heads up? Or would it make you afraid? God protects us from so many things that we don't know are happening in the background. You are sitting here today because God prevented an accident. God prevented a sickness from taking your life. God prevented so much. But because we are so focused on ourselves, we don't care about all that. We care about what's happening right now. So here's a statement for you. Learn to trust that what you don't know, God does. Learn to trust that what you don't know, God does. God knows the people that love you. He knows the people that hate you. God knows the people that will benefit you. God knows the people that will take from you. God knows the people that are praying for you. In fact, he even knows the people that are saying they're praying but are not praying at all. Just because they message in the group and say, hang in there, girl, praying for you, doesn't mean they are praying for you. They just sent a text message. They make promises they don't keep, but God is in the promise-keeping business. But we are so focused on what's happening right now that we don't know what's happening around us. Final thought. God spoke. A donkey spoke. An angel spoke. But Balaam didn't learn anything. Do you know that Balaam never converted at all? In fact, Balaam mastered the art of cursing even better. Balaam learned that you can't curse people who are blessed until you get them to do something to remove the blessing. And so what Balaam said is, he told the king, send women into the camp. Send people with money. Send all these idolatrous people into the kingdom. That will destroy them. And that's what happened. Because the devil knows if he can't curse you, he'll make you curse yourself. And if there's anything we have mastered, is the ability to curse ourselves. God spoke. A donkey spoke. An angel spoke. Balaam didn't learn anything. My question this morning is, have you? Lord, teach me to learn, to be continued. Lord, teach me to learn. Teach me to understand that when you tell me what to do, me obeying you has results that are better than not obeying you. That's universal. Since the beginning of time, that's all God has ever said. Do what I say and live. Don't eat the fruit. I've made millions of other trees. But then Eve was like, I'll be like God if I eat this one. We are in the business of not listening. And I'm saying to you, with all the love that I can master, God says, there's life, there's death. Choose life. He even knows that in the midst of two choices, we are so dumb, we will choose the wrong one. So he tells you the answer. Here's a quiz, life or death? Choose life. Red neon arrows pointing at life. We're like, forget life, I want death. That's what we do. That's what I do. Because death is exciting, it's exhilarating. It's like driving with your eyes closed. The government says, drive on the left side. You're like, no, I want to drive on the right side. Live in the moment. Pastor, I want God to help me to start listening. I don't want to be like Balaam. I don't want to negotiate my way out of obedience. I want to learn to listen. Not to the preacher. You don't have to listen to me. I got my own issues. Listen to God. Amen? Listen to God. If you learn to listen to God, you will notice changes in your life you've never ever thought about before. So keep calm. And learn. If that's your prayer, I want you to stand to your feet right now. I want to keep learning. I want to do my best to learn. That's the message for today. I want to learn. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Heavenly Father, the Bible is filled with so many mysterious, strange stories where donkeys talk, where lions kill donkeys but don't kill human beings. Stories where snakes are talking. And it's all in an effort to teach us that obedience is better than sacrifice. That sometimes we make choices that we consciously know are against the will of God. But something in the back of our mind says, it will work out anyway. We look for people that validate our bad choices. We look for people that lead us astray because we are in good company. And yet today, Lord, in this to be continued story, Balaam was never clear about what God was saying. Because for Balaam, the money mattered more than what God said. I hope that the message was clear to somebody that waiting for God to change his mind is a dangerous proposition when it comes to spirituality. It's not what the preacher says, it's what the word of God says. That to obey is better than sacrifice. Don't sacrifice yourself. Don't sacrifice your time. Don't sacrifice your resources to disobey God because you will lose something anyway. And so I pray, Heavenly Father, that as we leave this place, may we leave with the understanding that obeying the Lord is better. It may not be popular. May not be convenient. In fact, sometimes you lose something in the physical realm. You will lose an opportunity, you will lose a relationship, you will lose money, you will lose a possible enrichment experience. But simply because you said, I would rather follow what God says. There are some people that think there's a price tag on them. There are people who are for sale. And I'm asking you, Lord, please remove that price tag and say, paid in full by the grace of God. Help somebody today. Not to sell out for a season, only to suffer for eternity. Help somebody to understand that when God says no, God means no, and it's for your good. As 2020 comes around the corner, give us the spirit of learning. Now, Lord, I pray that you may give us the spirit of giving. As our offering plate goes around, the greatest evidence that somebody is free from greed is the ability to give. Giving frees us from the sin that Balaam suffered from. And so I pray that as we see the plate coming, may we, in an act of obedience and love for God, give from the heart. Please bless us, Lord, by watching over us. Please keep us, Lord, by lifting us up when we fall. Please guide us, Lord, by walking ahead of us in the way. Please encourage us, Lord, by walking behind us so that we would never go astray. Please protect us, Lord, by walking around us. Please be our friend by walking by our side. But above all things, teach us to learn by residing in our hearts.